Good to see you all here this morning. I'm glad you made it a priority to be here in worship after what we talked about last week. I'm glad you're here. I got to be honest with you, I had one of the greatest weeks ever this week. I went to Mission College through the IMB, and it was a four-day study from 7 in the morning till 8 at night. We were in class, and it was great. I got to say, it was good. We just got to meet all these missionaries from Peru and Brazil and Tibet and China and Japan. I mean, just from all over the world, and just got to talk to them about what it was for them to be missionaries. Some of them had been missionaries for, one guy was 41 years and another couple was 38. But we talked about a lot about the Americas, which is North, Central, South America. And they said that there are 600 million people in the Americas that are unreached, unengaged, lost. No, I'm sorry, lost. 497 people groups are unreached and unengaged, if you can believe that. There are 60 people groups that are uncontacted. I mean, they don't even know the name Jesus Christ. They've never heard it. And then they start talking about Asia. You know, 600 million is nothing when you start talking about Asia. You go into Middle East, into China, into Japan, you're talking billions of people. In those peoples, there are 2,563 unengaged, unreached people groups. People that just don't have any presence of the gospel there. And they talked about how churches like us can partner, pick a unreached people group, help plant churches, help support pastors, help go on mission trips and spread the word. It was inspiring. I got to tell you, it was good. And if anyone would like to talk about what that looks like for a church, I'm all on board. Anyone wants to start that up with me, I'm there. I'm praying. I'm praying about what people group God might want this church to go after, to look at. So, just a good week, man. I was in worship. It was good. I couldn't wait to be here this morning. You know, we're in a series about the church. We are in a series looking at Ewing Baptist Church. And I said last week, that's a scary thing when we start looking at us. Easy to look at everybody else, hard to look at us. I wanted to start fresh this year with clear vision of why we exist. In Scriptures, it says, where there is no vision, people perish. And I would add to that, where there is no vision, churches perish. I don't want this church to go through that. I want to start by defining what our purpose is, what our mission is. I want us all to know what our plan to fulfill that mission is. I saw a quote this week by Zig Ziglar. It says, if you aim at nothing, you will hit it every time. I want to hit something. I want this church to have purpose. I want to know the steps we get there and what we do. So 2 weeks ago, you know, we started with the very basics. You know, talking about what church is, why I love the church. And Jonathan, take that sermon and he assures me that I'm going to have a link today. So when I get that link, I'm going to put him on the spot. When I get that link, I want you to share it with people that have drifted out of church, that don't see the importance of church anymore. I want you to watch it with them. I want you to encourage them through it. People that have lost the ability to see why church is important, I want you to show it to them. So I'll have it today or tomorrow or as soon as Jonathan gets it to me.
Working on it.
No, he's doing good. Last week, we started into looking at how we put feet on that, you know, how we put our mission statement into action. Who can tell me what our mission statement is?
Building
God's kingdom one life at a time. Now this one's going to be a little harder. Who can tell me what the first step in that is that I talked about last week? Express our love to God through worship. I want these to roll off your tongue without effort. I want you to know these things just from reflex. When I say, what is our mission statement? I want you to say, building God's kingdom one life at a time. When I say, what's step one, step two, step three, step four, step five? I want you to know those. Because that's why we exist. That's why we are here. Everything we do needs to be because of this. Because of our purpose. Because of our mission. What God has told us as a church we are to do. You know, last week it was express our love to God through worship. We saw that everything revolves around worship. Worship is the most important ministry in this church right now. And everything starts with worship. That's the first step. That's the entry point. That's where we get people moving in to our mission and in the steps of our purpose. The second step in that process is become more Christ-like through discipleship. Become more Christ-like through discipleship. I'm going to go ahead and pray here. If we could all bow. Father, I thank you. I thank you so much, God, for this church. I thank you so much for the just privilege to come here with my brothers and sisters in Christ and worship you. And I pray that everything that is said, everything we do, just brings you honor and glory. And Lord, I pray that we learn. I pray that this is the start of discipleship. I pray that you have prepared our hearts for worship, that we have taken time to prepare our hearts for worship, and that what happens now, as we speak your word, it transforms us. It changes us. It makes us look more like Christ. I pray, Lord, that we are never satisfied with unchanging faith, ungrowing faith. That we're never satisfied with just staying infants in Christ. Father, I pray right now that we hear your words. And wherever, Lord, that I in my humanness fail, I pray that your word still gets out, that we still hear your message. So please, God, get me out of the way. This is too important to miss. Please teach us on discipleship. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So I think the first thing we have to get straight is, what is discipleship? If you're a note taker, that's number one in the bulletin. What is discipleship? That, the definition of a disciple, which is the root word of discipleship, is a learner. A disciple is a learner. It's a person who is a pupil to the doctrines of another, sits under the tutelage, the teaching of someone else. But it doesn't stop there. A disciple also is one who embraces those teachings, assists in spreading those teachings to other people. They are a follower of the teacher, of another person. So a disciple of Christ is not only called to learn the teachings of Jesus Christ, they are also called to live them and to follow them and to become more like him more and more every day. Discipleship then is the steps. Now that's a disciple. Discipleship is then the steps that we take to be a disciple. Discipleship just doesn't by osmosis come into us. It doesn't automatically happen. There are steps that we have to take. It's a path that we have to follow to where we learn and grow and live and become more like Christ. Here's the order of those events in discipleship. It has to go just like this or it will not work. Number one, we are saved by Christ alone. That's number one in discipleship. There's no reason for discipleship if you're not saved. There's just no reason for it. A lost person doesn't need to be discipled. Ephesians 2:8, it says, "For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God." And then 9 says, "Not by works, so that no one can boast." And a lot of people just want to leave it right there. Saved by grace. Nothing else matters. But if you go on and read the rest, verse 10, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." So number one, saved by Christ alone, saved by grace. Number two, when we have experienced God's saving grace, our automatic response, our immediate response is to dedicate our lives to Him. We live for Him. Galatians 5:13, it says, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love." The gospel doesn't set us free from sin to do our own thing. The gospel does not set us free from sin to do nothing. It's freedom not to follow Christ. Salvation is free, but it will cost you everything. After salvation, we now have the ability and the responsibility to become more like Him, to become His disciple. Discipleship is a lifelong learning and growing process where we surrender to His will and His plan and His mission and His life for us. So the next question, that's discipleship. Next question we have to answer is, who cares? Why bother? Why do it? Isn't salvation enough? Isn't eternity enough? If you read Ephesians 2:8, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is a gift from God. And don't read any other part of the Bible, you might ask that. But if you read anything else in the Bible, you got to know, why is discipleship important to us? Why is discipleship important to the church? Number one, in your notes, it has to be important to us because it was important to Jesus. It was vital to Jesus. John 8:31-32, it says, to the Jews who had believed Him, Jesus said, if you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And in Matthew 16:24-25, then Jesus said to His disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it. Jesus begins His ministry by picking 12 disciples, 12 guys. And He spends time with them. He shares His life with them. He pours into them. He mentors them. He teaches them. He grows them in His likeness. They are His disciples, His 12 disciples. He didn't pick the most famous people. He didn't pick the most rich, the most knowledgeable, the best looking, and not even the best character. He just picked people like us. And Jesus' purpose and focus for His 3-year ministry on earth was discipleship. He was equipping the 12 disciples to take over for Him when He left. In the last week of Jesus' earthly life, He was eating a Passover meal with His disciples. He got up from the meal, took off His outer clothing, and He wrapped a towel around His waist. And after that, He poured water into a basin, and He begins to wash His disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around Him. And it says in John 13:12-17, when He had finished washing their feet, He put on His clothes and returned to His place. Do you understand what I have done for you? He asked them. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. But now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. Jesus gives us the greatest example of discipleship to follow in His footsteps, to do what He did, to become like Him. It's important to Him because His mission and His plan are on the disciples. We are to become like Him. So why is discipleship important? Number two, God set it up this way so we would grow and mature in faith. Ephesians 4:11-17, it says, so Christ Himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers to equip His people for works of service so that the body of Christ might be built up until we reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves, and blown here and there by every wind of teaching, and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect a mature body of Him who is the head, and that is Christ. From Him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. So I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. Just as a baby is born and immediately starts to grow and mature, we are not saved so we can sit in our diapers and wait for our next bottle forever. We immediately are to grow and mature in Christ. You know, if we are saved and stay immature in the faith, we miss out what Christianity is meant to be. We totally miss the point. Without discipleship, people will be confused by Scripture and what it means for their lives. Without discipleship, they will be swept away, it says, by any false doctrine that comes along. You don't know truth if you're not in discipleship. And if you're not in discipleship, people will live for themselves. Live for moments of pleasure. They won't live for Christ. They won't live for eternal reward. Without discipleship, they won't experience abundant life. They will experience a life of worry and fear and anxiety. You know, without discipleship, they won't know how to deal with temptation. They won't know what Jesus did. So we can see what discipleship was in the Acts 2 church. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Every day they continued to meet together in temple courts. They were praising God in homes. You know, this was a church devoted to learning. They met in large meetings, and then they met in small. Here at Ewing Baptist Church, discipleship starts in worship. This is the large setting. That's the model that we're following. You know, if you notice the words that were on the screens when we sang those songs, some of that was the gospel message. We grow from hearing that. Discipleship is happening right now as we preach God's word. You know, this series is a little different for me. I usually don't preach this way. You know, I preach through books of the Bible. I preach through large sections of Scripture, word for word, verse by verse. I could just not preach at all and just have music. I could just preach self-help, better life type Scripture. All right, it's not even Scripture. It's you pick a point and you cherry pick all the Scripture that makes that point and you bring it all together and let's all just have a better life. I want to preach in a way that disciples you. I want to preach through God's Word. This is the beginning of discipleship. Again, that's why it's imperative why you are here in worship every week. This is where it starts. This is where it all begins. But sadly, this is where discipleship ends for many. Many people never take it to the next step into a small group setting. Tom Rainer says in his book, I Will, those church members who become involved in small groups in churches were 5 times more likely to be active in a church 5 years later compared to the worship-only attenders. And then he goes on to say, we cannot grow effectively as a believer in isolation. And then he also says, if you are not in a small group, a Sunday school class, or some other type of group, you are not contributing to the health of the church. Those are strong words. Here at Ewing Baptist Church, our process of discipleship goes from worship service, big group, to morning Sunday school, small group, to Sunday evening study, small group. Sunday school is not just for kids, let me tell you. You know, we do have Sunday school for all ages, from nursery on up to as old as you can possibly be. We have a class for you. Sunday school is important. It is relevant for our day. Today, we talked about what is your purpose in life in Sunday school. You know, over the last month or so, we've talked about Psalm 119, about being in God's Word and how rich that is. It has blessed me. And there's other Sunday school classes going through other things. Here's what one article said about Sunday school. It's where we engage in real conversations about God and His Word while making friends and establishing bonds of love and fellowship. Since Sunday school classes are typically small, it is the perfect environment to engage in real conversation about the Word. By engaging in dialogue with other members of the class, listening to their questions, and hearing the answers, You learn that you are not alone in your struggles to understanding the Word and living out your faith in this world that is increasingly hostile to Christians. As you recognize and embrace that common bond, you develop friendships that will last a lifetime. Those friendships will also help keep you accountable and connected to the body of Christ, especially during times of storm and crisis in your life. Each of us needs to be plugged into a Sunday school class. There are so many benefits of being in that small group. And Sunday evening studies? Let me tell you right now, Sunday evening studies is not a bunch of Bible scholars sitting around smoking their pipes, rubbing their beards, talking about the theory of premillennialism in a postmillennial world. That's not what it is. It's a small group where we come together and we talk about what it is to be a Christian. You know, what we're studying right now? It's how to be connected in a church, how to be part of a church, how to be a member in a church. And we have a study for every age, again, because discipleship is for every age. Yeah, discipleship, let me go on before I get on my soapbox. Discipleship is important. These small groups are places where we dive into Scripture and into deeper study. It's where we interact and have discussion with each other about God's Word. It's where we ask questions. It's where we share doubts and fears. It's where we tackle hard truths. Proverbs 27:17, I love this verse. As iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. If you're not together, there's no sharpening going on. It's just you and whatever you think. Small discipleship groups are where we learn to grow. It's where we encourage each other. It's where we challenge each other. And I don't know if you know how blessed we are to have the privilege to do this every Sunday and other nights of the week, other times of the week. I don't know if you know how privileged we are. There was a guy that spoke this week, John Brady. He's the Vice President of Global Engagement for the IMB. And he was talking about he spent time in China. And these people, the Christians there, were in hiding. There was a group of ladies that got together a couple days a week in hiding so they could get together in a small group. He said they invited him to come to one. And he said they went into a greenhouse in hiding, and they covered the Bible for 10 hours. They were devoted. They knew how important it was. Do you understand what a privilege it is to sit here and not be worried about if troops are going to come in, if somebody's going to get killed, if I'm going to be hauled off to prison? Such a blessing that we take so for granted. So why don't people go? Why don't they go to small groups? Why don't they be discipled? Why is that an option for some people? Maybe they're afraid to grow, afraid to change. Maybe they already know everything there is to know. No reason to go. You know, I gotta say, if that's you, you're a bunch of little Billy Grahams running around there, come teach me. Because I don't have it figured out yet. If you know everything, teach us poor, miserable slugs that are spiritually underdeveloped. Maybe you just don't have time to invest in your spiritual lives. It's not important enough. I don't know how that works. I don't know how it could not be important enough. If you go by what Rainer says, maybe you're not committed to this church. Maybe you're not committed to the mission Jesus Christ gave us. Week after week, year after year, many people stay in the exact same spiritual condition. It's like they're in a holding tank, never moving into any greater level of commitment. They stay babies in faith. Their lives being built up for the kingdom, it's just stalled out. Going to the next step, they've just stopped. And their growth is stunted. Paul addresses this in 1 Corinthians 3, 1 through 3. Brothers and sisters, I could not address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you are not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly. He's talking to Christians right here. You know what I want for you? This is what I want. I want you to step up to the table and be ready to eat a steak. I want this to be solid food. I want you to be desiring, longing for meat. And some of you do. But many of you just come to church waiting for this. That's not what I want for you. That's frustrating for me as a pastor. I got to be honest. That is frustrating. I can't do this for you. I cannot make you be discipled. It kills me. I want to. I can remember in youth group when I was a youth pastor, and I went through a frustrating time where the kids weren't getting it. They weren't understanding. They weren't sitting through it. They weren't being discipled. And I said, you know what? If I could beat this into your head, I would. Probably not the youth pastor you would want. But it's true. I want you to get this no matter how. And really, there were some kids there that I probably would have enjoyed that teaching style a little too much if I was allowed to do that. If there was a magic drink to give you, I would give it to you. If there was something I could do, I would do it. I want you to be discipled. I want you to get this Jesus' mission. Without discipleship, you miss the whole plan. You miss His calling. You miss His mission. And all I can do is encourage you. It's frustrating. I want so much more for you. I want so much more for this church. I am not satisfied with stagnant, non-moving faith anymore. Not mine and not yours. It hurts this church. And it hurts people I love. It hurts you. When you do not step out in faith and be discipled and disciple others. But somehow it appears that you can have a shallow, non-growing relationship with Jesus, if that's what you want. It must be okay, because it seems like it's in every church. Every pastor I talk to has this problem. But I don't understand it. I don't understand how or why that could be, because I don't see it in Scripture. I don't see it in the Bible. What I see is when you give your life to Christ, you are transformed. Your heart is transformed. Your mind is transformed. The purpose you exist is transformed. The mission you are on is transformed. It's all in a new life wrapped up in Christ. If you love the church and you are committed to the church, you are devoted to worship, you want Jesus' plan for your life, you can't just quit being a disciple. You can't let it stop there. Spiritual movement has to continue. You have to take next steps. Our lives should be transformed every day, more and more like Christ. Every day, we should be looking and acting more like Jesus. Every day. We should become more loving. Loving God with all our heart and our soul and our mind. We should be loving our neighbor as ourselves. This is a never-ending process of transformation. While you are alive, you should be growing. From the birth, or I should say rebirth, of a new Christian till the day they pass on, there should be growing. There should be discipleship. Because here's what's coming. As we grow in discipleship, as we mature, then we can move to the next steps. We go from worship to discipleship, and then from there, that gets us a longing, just something that gets in our hearts that we want to do ministry, we want to serve, we want to evangelize, we want people to know what we know and got what we got. But without discipleship, you will just stall out. Next steps don't come. There's no maturing. You won't take any movement into ministry and serving and evangelism. It'll just stop. So I encourage you, love this church. Be here. Be an active part of the body. Be a participant. Commit to worship every week. Make worship your number one priority. Nothing can keep you away. Nothing is more important. Come here expecting to engage God in deep worship. Get your heart ready for worship. Use the sermon as your jumping point into discipleship, not the end point. Get involved in a Sunday school class. We have 7 adult Sunday school classes. That is unheard of for a church our size. Unheard of. I was talking to a pastor of a church our size, and he asked me, "What does your Sunday school class study?" And I said, I went through them all in my head. I said, "We got 7 adult classes." And he says, "Are you kidding me? How do you have leaders to teach all those? How do you have people to attend all those? We got 1 class we have in the sanctuary and I teach it," he said. We are so blessed. We have classes that are teaching different things. We have classes that are just for women, classes that are just for men. Classes, we got a class for you if you are not in Sunday school. Be an active member in that Sunday school class. Prepare. Look at your book. Study. Go into that Sunday school room ready to talk, ready to discuss, ready to grow, ready to learn. And parents, I can't believe how many times I hear this. The parent will be in Sunday school, especially as kids get older, and the child won't be there. They'll be like, "Where's your kid at?" "Oh, they didn't want to come." Really? Your kid has a choice? He's a kid. You're a parent. You're the adult. You make them come. That's all there is to it. I don't see what the question is. It is too important to let your kids do whatever they want to do. You know, the youth pastor that I mentored under, if he said it once, he said it 1,000 times. When I was a kid, I had a drug problem. My parents drugged me to church every Sunday. And he says, "I appreciate that." Parents, bring your kids to Sunday school. Make it a priority to come to Sunday night study. Be prepared. Ask questions. Discuss in love. Sharpen each other as iron sharpens iron. We sit in here on Sunday night and there's rich discussion. It is times where we grow and we learn. If you are going to a Sunday school class, if you're going to Sunday night study, if you're going to Tammy's small group study, invite other people. Most people are going to have a hard time going on their own. Invite them to come with you. Sit with them. Make them feel good about it. Encourage them. From the second you are saved, be a learner. Be growing. Desire transformation in your life. Don't settle as long as you live. Don't ever settle for that. We are never to stay the same. There is to be constant growth. We are to grow more and more like Christ every day. And you might be asking, why should we grow in Christ's image? Why should we look more and more like Christ? Why should we be more and more like Christ? And I'll give you the reason. Because He died for you. Because He lived and died on your behalf. Because He willingly gave up His life to pay the penalty for your sin. He took your debt, He took your pain, your punishment, your sin, and died on a cross. Why should I be a disciple? Just because of that. Right there. No other reason. And He says to, "For what He did for me, I'm going to be the disciple. And I'm going to be on His plan and His mission for my entire life till the second I die." Our mission statement is building God's kingdom one life at a time. To fulfill that mission in this church, this is the way we have set it up. We have to start with worship. And then we move into the next step, which is discipleship.